Hello and welcome to everyone to this new episode of Rupture with Gil. Today is a different and a special kind of episode because we've finally invited someone else who's not from cricket. There's been only one so far where we had Anindya Datta, and today we are venturing into a different sport. I have with me a professional footballer who's now turned into a football pundit and a commentator, Darren Caldiera, with me. Welcome, Darren, to the show. I hope you enjoy the conversation that we have from there.
Thank you, Gurkira. Thank you so much for having me. I'm looking forward to this, to be honest.
Now, so Darren, you know, before I ask you anything else about the sport or whatever you've been doing now with your commentary and everything, I just want, you know, want you to take our viewers through what has been your journey. As you know, when did your affair with football started? You know, when was the time that you decided, okay, now I want to play this sport professionally? Just take us through your journey a little bit.
Yeah, I think it was like any other sportsman for that matter. Yeah, it started with, you know, at school levels, you know, when I'd like to say this a quick story that my mom keeps telling me, that apparently when she took me for admissions the first time to school, and she had to just leave me for a couple of minutes to check something out on some school notice board. I went running to like the playground and watched, you know, some of the boys kick the football around. So I think, you know, that's how I think I had my first love. You know, you kind of realize that I think that's why football was something that mattered to me a lot. And it started from the school levels, your under sixes and under eights and under tens. You know, I started playing for the school football team, and it went ahead with your under 12s, under 14. So basically throughout school, I ended up playing football, and I was also in a school that predominantly was dominated by a lot of good footballers. We had a lot of good footballers coming from my school, and you know, everyone played throughout, whether it was your lunch breaks or your, you know, your shorter breaks, and or before school for that matter, a lot of us would get in early, an hour earlier to school just to play football. So it started, you know, pretty much started from there. But at that point, I never thought that maybe I wanted to play the sport professionally. It was just something, you know, growing up as a kid, I watched a lot of footballers and things like that. But I never thought of, okay, you know, I will be a professional footballer one day. It was just something I enjoyed doing a lot. And, you know, along with academics, I know I ignored my studies. But as soon as I was done with homework or whatever, I would just rush to go play football. But for that matter, I love cricket as well. I mean, I played a lot of cricket in school. It's something I do now as well. You know, when I get time and there are like friends playing around me, like book, you know, one of those smaller grounds, AstroTurf, and play some box cricket. But yeah, football was something that I was kind of inclined towards. And as soon as I was done with school, I actually took up science for some reason, because I thought I wanted to. It was because of one of my tuition teachers actually, and her son was in the Merchant Navy, and he was somebody I would look up to, like. I would look up to him, and you know, he was a smart guy, spoke well, and he always told me, like, getting into Merchant Navy is not that hard. You know, you just need to do science the first 2 years. You don't have to get like your 90%, because I was not that sort of a student who would get your 90-95%. And he said, you know, you might want to do that. So I took up science thinking maybe, you know what, I could become like him. But I also love football on the side. So I was playing football constantly, like all the time. And I had my science practicals on the side, and I realized this is just not me. I can't wear like a lab coat and go to a chemistry lab, and you know, all I was thinking was like playing sport there. So I realized at that point in junior college that, you know, this is when I was 16, I think 17, I realized I can't continue with science, because I don't think this is for me. And 17 was when I remember the first time I actually, it was 16, 17 when I, there was this team in Bombay called Mahindra United. Back then it was one of the biggest Indian football clubs. And for the first time they were having these open trials for under 19 team, which was like massive at that point. You never heard of it, like a big Indian football club having open trials. So I remember, like, I didn't really want to go for it, but I had a really close friend of mine who was also, you know, really good at football, and one of my best friends. He was like, let's just go for it, you know, it's going to be fun and things like that. And I was like, okay, you know, let's give it a shot. And we actually went there, and there were like more than 500 kids, I kid you not, more than 500 kids competing to like make the top 20 or 25 for that matter. And the trials went on for close to a month, you know, like from 500, they must have got down to like 400, 300, you know, 200. And I remember the last 50 was like, they went on for like the last 10 days. They really wanted to make sure, you got to get credit to the club, then they want to make sure they want to get the best of you know the best 20 or the best 25. Unfortunately, somehow I made the cut, and I think that's from where my journey kind of began, and where I realized that this is what I want to do, because I got into the under-19 team, and a few times when I was with the under-19 team, so what generally happens is with the senior team, you know, a few times if they have a couple of players out injured and they're looking at a couple of the junior players, they'll call in two or three players from the junior team to come train with them. So a couple of times I got called up to the senior team to train with them, and that would just be like, that would just make my day. That was like, I'm getting to train with the senior team. That's all that matters at the moment. I would just be like in awe, just looking at all the players around, you know, your Indian players who are playing for the national team. You got foreigners, some of the best foreigners coming to India and, you know, playing here. And I was just like, wow, this is amazing. This is what I want to do. And that's when I decided also I needed to stop with science. So I kind of swapped to arts, because I thought like arts is something where I could maybe somehow manage to complete my education and play at the same time, which was a struggle. I feel like that's one of the biggest struggles for you know, footballers in India, or for that matter, just sportsmen in India, to like study and you know, play at the same time. But yeah, my journey began from there. Like, I think that's how I got into football professionally then.
You know, quite a lot of things that you mentioned over here. The last one being that how it would made your day when you would, you know, be allowed to play in a higher age group. I think, you know, I've not played that much, but I clearly remember that, you know, whenever you would go, even for a school team or something, whenever you were asked to play, like if you were in 8th standard and you were asked to play for the 10th standard team, there was a different kind of pride. You would just walk with a different body language. Like, you know, like I'm the Don, I'm the one who's been selected. So that is something that I think a lot of people can relate to. The other thing which you mentioned quite interestingly was, you know, how it was junior college and not school, because a lot of people in you know, North India get confused with it, because you know, in Delhi, I've grown up in Delhi. In Delhi, you're yeah. school till 12th, so you know, you're still in school and you have to wear that lab coat and everything.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just wanted to make it clear. But I think and what you told about the Merchant Navy, I think it's just that when we are in school, we think that getting these 90% and 80% marks is going to be much harder than, you know, doing all those jobs. But all of us realize it later on that it's still one of the relatively easier things that you can do in life. Now, you mentioned about how one of the challenges was, you know, managing the academics along with, you know, managing football. I think a lot of people, like you said, a lot of people who take up sport, all that. But I'm sure there are other challenges that also come a long way. And I don't think any of them reduce as you keep moving, you know, a level above. Like when you're playing under 17, there's a different challenge. When you move to under 19, there's a different challenge. So what are these particular challenges, you know, which are, you know, just specific to football and, you know, you feel can be addressed if the structure of grassroots football and you know, domestic football in the country improves?
Like you said, there are so many challenges while growing up, right from, you know, your 10 years of age till like you hit like 16-17, and then you get into maybe your senior team later on. And grassroots, yeah, like you mentioned, this is just a bit of a tidbit and something I read very recently about, for example, Messi. I mean, he's known worldwide, everyone knows of Messi. He's probably one of the best players in the world right now. And like, for example, a Messi at his age, like when he was 4 or 5, he was actually playing 4 to 5 football matches a week, and he did that for like an entire year. So from the age of 4 till now, he's been playing around 3 or 4 games a week. You know, I mean, now it's professional football, but as a kid while growing up, I think that's what we miss in India at the moment. Because you never hear of a 4 or 5 year old, a 6 year old, or a 7 year old actually playing, training in a proper system, or playing, you know, 3 games a week or 2 games a week. You know, sometimes a 6-7 year old will be going to like just train.
I'm not even sure if academies allow for someone who's below 8 or below 10 at a lot of places. And I think it's not just restricted to probably football; it's restricted to cricket as well. I'm not sure if, you know, below eight year olds are even allowed at academy.
Yeah, which is why, you know, we constantly get that question. You know, we're a 1.3, 1.4 billion population. Why can't we produce like an Indian team that makes the World Cup, or why can't we produce another Ronaldo or a Messi? But this is one of the reasons why we are struggling, is because if you compare ourselves to the Europeans, like for example, a Messi, I said, even tomorrow, a Rashford, a well-known name, a Rooney, all of them have started from like ages of like 5 and 6 and 7, when they are in a proper training system, playing football matches. And we probably start this when, you know, when we're around 13 or 14 or 15, and we're losing out on already, say, 8 to 10 years, and that's massive. Imagine 8 to 10 years of not learning a sport and not playing football, and then you suddenly have to pick up and you're obviously lagging behind. So that's something that probably could be addressed, which they are doing at the moment. You see a lot of the federation here in India have started something known as the baby league, where you have kids of like 6 and 7 year olds are starting to play football matches, and you know, they're trying to extend the leagues and make it longer. So this is the way forward, I feel, you know, because we can't tomorrow. I'm giving my example, like for me, when I was in school, we used to have, you know, your football coaching in school, say twice a week or thrice a week, and that was during the monsoons. And you play your inter-school matches and then that's it, you're done with it. What after that, you know, like imagine the rest of the year, you're not training in a proper system, you're not playing enough for matches, and you're only going to get better as a footballer if you continue playing matches. I mean, you can train as much as you want, but when you're in a match situation with like opponents who are trying to kick you, with maybe crowds around you, that's a completely different scenario. So you can train as much as you want, but you have to couple that with football matches, which is where I think we lack. Because if you look at any other European country, if not even Asian countries, like your Japan or a South Korea for that matter, they've got a proper structure and system in place. So we need to focus more on grassroots, on the younger kids coming in. We need to get them to train more in a proper training facility with a lot of matches. And I don't see why, if we follow that routine and we follow that system, where we can, I won't say we produce the next Messi or a Ronaldo for that matter, but we produce a team that is getting, you know, can compete with the better nations in Asia, and then hopefully in the future in Europe as well.
Talking of European clubs, I'm not sure how many know this, but you had a 1 year sort of a stint with Valencia as well, where, you know, you were a part of that academy. So how was that experience, and how was that experience different from, you know, all the clubs that you played in India with or trained with? Just take us through that process, that what is it that they do differently, and then what do Indian clubs do differently amongst themselves also?
Yeah, so I mean, I had a great time in Valencia. That 1 year was just brilliant. There was so much to learn culturally, and you know, I learned a new language. I met a lot of nice people there who I'm still in touch with. And yes, I, you know, I was training at Valencia with the coaches there, and you know, I had access to also watching the senior team train, as well as the different age groups, right from your 6-7 year olds till your 18 year olds. So I would spend a lot of time watching, you know, the younger kids as well. And it was so nice to watch, because you had like 6 and 7 year olds not just running around on the football field, kicking the ball or running around aimlessly. You know, like there was a lot of, it was structured training. You had coaches explaining to them, you know, what should be done when you have the ball, maybe the other player should move around here, how you could pass and things like that, which is nice to see. You don't see that a lot in Indian football. You find, you know, some of the places where you just get the kids together and, you know, you just make them have fun. I mean, fun is important, but it has to be coupled with a bit of learning as well. So I feel that's the difference probably in Spain and here at the moment. But I think the Indian football and the federation, they're doing quite a bit. You've seen that they are trying to get a lot of younger kids into the sport, trying to give them good coaching. And I feel that's the difference between us and them at the moment. You know, just getting that bit of coaching and that structure in football as a sport. And I feel like in Spain, also, if you look at football, it's kind of compared to how cricket is here. You know, everyone loves the sport. Every single member of the family is watching football. They know what's happening in the Spanish leagues, in the lower leagues as well. You know, as soon as the weekend arrives, you know, it's like a weekend for them. There'll be a weekend football match to watch. They'll go out and play football as well. And it's kind of like a party there every weekend. But yeah, I mean, football is getting bigger here. Definitely getting bigger here. You can see the leagues now. They are like, there's a lot of people who are showing a lot of interest. A lot of my friends who would not watch Indian football previously, who would only talk about your Manchester United or your Real Madrid, are now talking about Indian football clubs. So it's good to watch. And, you know, I love having these conversations with them, educating them a bit about also what's happening in Indian football.
Interestingly, from what I gathered in this answer was that what what if you were to give a crux of it, it was just that in European countries and in countries where the structure is a lot better, what we talk of, you know, giving method to madness, that happens at a much, much earlier stage than what we do here. And that is why, you know, you said that even if six, 7 years olds are playing, they're not just running around. There's a proper, you know, way in their playing. There's a formation and everything, etc. Now, you know, you yourself also play, apart from that 1 year in Valencia, you've played with a lot of clubs, even in the Indian circuit. You've played with Bangalore FC, you've played with ATK, you've played with Kerala Blasters. I think you've also played with for Mumbai FC, I think. So, you know, playing for which club was your best experience? Or if not the best, because, you know, you can't really measure which one's better, because there are different learning curves which every experience brings along with it. But, you know, just one, you know, which, by playing for which club would you say that you learned or grew as a player the most? Maybe it had to do with your own maturity that came into the fore, because you'd already been playing for a lot of time, or was it just, you know, the facilities that had been with the club, or, you know, just a combination of all the factors?
I say for that matter, like every single club that I played for, there was always, you know, a lot of positives, a lot of learnings. So it's difficult to pick out just one single club, but, you know, I'll have to mention Mumbai FC was the club basically that I started out with, where I had my first, you know, full-fledged season. And that's when I realized how Indian football works and, you know, how it is coming up against the best in the country, playing against national team players and things like that. So there was a lot of learning with my first season with Mumbai FC. And, you know, I cannot ignore clubs like Bengaluru FC, another club where I would say that was the first professional club that I was at. I felt Bengaluru FC were one of the clubs to bring in a lot of professionalism in Indian football back then, which was unheard of, you know, with things like they got in things like your fat tests, and they got in hydration tests, and they got in things like regular, they would check your body weight, and you had, you know, regular sprint tests and things like that, which were unheard of in football back then. This was like 2013 that I'm talking of. So they got a lot of professionalism, you know, into the sport. And I also very grateful because I won a lot of titles with Bengaluru FC. You know, the first time we were the national champions, the I-League champions, we won the Federation Cup. So I also got to represent, you know, on the AFC circuit, we play the AFC Cup, where you play against other you know, clubs from different countries. So we went to Indonesia, we went to Singapore, we went to Malaysia and played clubs there. So, you know, that was another learning. So we're so used to, you know, playing in India, and, you know, we got to play against clubs from other countries. So you just realize on what level is India, you know, you suddenly realize, oh my God, okay, the Malaysians are really, you know, they have a different style of play, and you kind of figure out the level India are at. And then you got, you know, Mohan Bagan, another massive club that I was with. There's so much of history and heritage behind the club. The fan following as well is massive. And, you know, I'd like to mention the Kolkata Derby. It's one game that a lot of people talk about when you talk about Indian football. And it's massive, you know, playing in front of 70,000 people. And it's not just on the game day that I mentioned. It's always the, you know, the build-up towards that game. You know, the week leading up to that game, where you walk wherever you're on the road, you'll have maybe a cab driver or a shopkeeper come and tell you, oh, listen, you have to beat this other team. We have to play well. Because, you know, football in Calcutta as well is massive. They love their football there. You've got Mohan Bagan, you've got East Bengal, so it's massive for them. And, yeah, and this Kerala Blasters, again, a massive club. I learned so much at the club. You know, you've got football in Kerala, again, is massive. You know, they're so passionate about the team. And they're always, you know, always behind their players, whether you win or lose, and they're always behind you. So there's a lot of learning at every club. I would say, you know, when it comes to facilities and things like that, I think the clubs are doing a lot better now. Bengaluru FC, Kerala Blasters, you know, ATK, Mohan Bagan, all of them are doing much, much better now. You have your gyms, you have access to pools, your massages and things like that. And training is also very structured now. So I think there's a lot of professionalism in Indian football at the moment.
I see. Now, just one thing that you'd mentioned while you were answering this, that when you would play against foreign clubs, you would realize the gulf that is there between, say, Indian football and the football that they were playing. Now, as an athlete, you know, that thing can either motivate you to do a lot better, or you know, it can even sort of demotivate you, or sort of, you know, make you frustrated or disappointed. How do you, you know, while you were still playing, would deal with it? Would you use it as an external motivation and, you know, make it a driver of ambition? Or, you know, was there also a realization that, okay, maybe this is something that we may not be able to do? So how was that, you know, a whole stream of emotions that comes along with experiences such as these?
Yeah, so I'd like to mention, as in after we won the league title with Bengaluru FC, we actually went for a pre-season tour to China before our season started. So we had a practice match against this team called Guangzhou RNF. So they are one of the best teams in China, really, really big team, well-funded. And they had Sven Goran Eriksson as their coach. He's like one of the well-known names. He also coached England at the World Cup and things like that. And I remember playing them, and I remember we were chasing the ball all game. We were struggling in that game because we realized the quality opposition that they were. And, you know, it was a game that we lost 2-0, but it could have been a lot more. And it was basically a game that we really struggled with. And I remember always coming back to the dressing room and looking at each other, and we were like, we are Indian champions, and we've come here and we've just kind of got battered, and how did this happen? Like, we were just like, okay, this is the level we are talking about. You know, we're not talking about Europe at the moment, we're talking about Asia, and this is the level in Asia. So it was, I won't say all of us were like a bit demotivated, but we got a good reality check to realize, okay, this is the level, and this is the level we aspire to reach at, you know. So obviously it was, you get back home, you get back to the training ground, start working again, working really hard. And that's when a lot of people discuss Indian football right now. They talk about, oh, why is India not playing in the World Cup? When is India going to play in the World Cup? But, you know, I keep having these conversations with people. I was like, first, we need to focus on Asia before we can think of a World Cup. So we need to start getting better in Asia. We need to start competing against the likes of Iran or Japan, South Korea, Australia, for that matter, before we can think of, you know, coming up against the Germans or Brazil, for that matter. So we need to start getting better in Asia, and, you know, then think about Europe. But I think we are heading in the right path. We are taking the steps forward. We're still not moving as swiftly as we should forward, but, you know, baby steps, and hopefully we will get there at some point.
Now, I was just about to ask you that, how much has the introduction of leagues like ISL and, you know, the professionalism in I-League has helped Indian sport, Indian football in the last 7-8 years. But I think you've painted a very good picture that it's brought in a lot more professionalism and, you know, a lot more methods of training, which are now aligning with the modern methods. So I don't think we need to, you know, discuss that anymore. But what I want to ask you from is that, how can Indian clubs, you know, make a more loyal fan base? Because I still feel, you know, sometimes, because I have friends who watch a lot of football, that the level of loyalty with that they have towards European clubs is still not the same that they have towards the Indian clubs. In fact, a lot of them still don't watch these Indian leagues with the same interest than what they do with, you know, while watching the EPL or the La Liga or any other European league for that matter. So how do you think that this bridge of loyalty can be, you know, made up by the Indian clubs?
Yeah. The thing is, every passing day, I've realized that there are more and more people, at least in India, that are, you know, watching a lot more Indian football from, you know, say 5 years ago to now. I'm not even going 10 years back, but just 5 years ago to now, I've seen a lot more people who are really interested in watching Indian football, who, you know, come in from the stadium and a club is playing or the national team are playing. And I think the clubs also have started doing a lot of fan engagement. You know, there's a lot of where they have, maybe they call fans over to watch a training session, or they have, they get a, you know, maybe a player on board and have a Zoom call with fans, you know. And like I said, there's a lot of fan engagement happening. I think that's the way forward. I think we need to, clubs need to reach out to the community as well, you know, help out, whether it's not only, you know, it could be anything else. Like, for example, we had a COVID situation. I've seen a lot of clubs helping out with, it could be with vaccination, or it could be, you know, just with helping out with essentials or things like that. So I think if you can get a lot of people in the community involved, and, you know, they a lot of people I know also are not even aware of maybe a football club in their city. Like, for example, I'm in Bombay at the moment, and you have Mumbai City FC. And I know a lot of people who know of Mumbai City FC, but I know a lot of people who also are not aware of the club being there. So I think it's important that the clubs do a lot of activities with the fans in the city to, you know, make them realize that there is a club, there is one of your own club in your own hometown, and you want to come out and support it. And I think that's one of the ways going forward. And I think it is getting better over the years, you know, because with the Hero ISL at the moment, you know, they have been broadcasting every single game. And even if you look at the quality of broadcast from Star Sports, I think it's fabulous with the kind of pitches that they're playing on, you know, the kind of camera work, the angles that's happening. You're getting, you know, a lot of people, a lot of ex-footballers or people who watch the sport and or play the sport, you know, coming and talking about it. And I think it's creating a lot of craze, and also there's quite a bit of buzz. And if you have to compare it to 5 years back to now, I think there's definitely been an increase. So I feel like it's only going to get better. And as long as clubs can, you know, engage with their fans, get them more involved, reach out to them and, you know, talk to them. And I think we are going to get better. It's not going to be long till you'll find, you know, a lot of Indian football fans talking about Indian football as much as they would talk about European football.
You mentioned broadcasting, and that brought me to my the next question. Now, you yourself are a broadcaster now. You're doing commentary. You are a football pundit now. How difficult or easy would you say is it as compared to your playing days? Do you think it's something, you know, which is much more easier because you know a lot about the game and have played it? Or do you think it's difficult because, like football, it's also incredibly real-time? And, you know, while playing, you had the manager screaming from the sidelines. And while you're being a broadcaster, you have one ear, you know, just completely dedicated from the production team saying something or the other, bringing up stats, etc. So how easy or difficult would you say this new journey of yours is?
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. You know, a lot of people are not aware of, including, like you just mentioned about, you know, 1 year, you've got the manager or the producer, whoever, somebody speaking in your ears. And it's something when I wasn't aware about the first time when I went into broadcasting. I just thought you hold a mic and you just speak about the sport, right? But it is not that. It's so the first time I remember going live, I remember speaking to these guys and they were like, you know, just keep it simple and, you know, talk about, you know, what we are supposed to talk about and things like that. And I was like, how hard can it be, right? You know, I mean, I've played in front of 70,000 people. It can't be that bad. But the first time I went live and after I was done with that, I was like, this is hard. You know, it requires, a lot of people are not aware, but there's a lot of prep work that goes before you go live. You know, you need to know every single player. You need to know stats. You need to know previous results and things like that. You know, so there's a lot of prep work, and it's just like any other live sport, right? There are no retakes. So if you mess up on live TV, you mess up straight away, and people are very quick to, you know, catch up or catch on these things. You know, everyone is on social media now. As soon as you say something silly or something that doesn't make sense, straight away there's a tweet on it. You know, people will be like, what is he trying to say? You know, what is that? And things like that. So I was very fortunate to get advice from a lot of people who've been in broadcast for a long time. So things like, you know, just simple advice, like from one of the guys, Paul Mayfield, who's been in this for long, like he mentioned something like KISS. He said, remember this term KISS, that is keep it simple, silly, always. Like when you get, at least the initial days, don't try anything fancy, don't try to say something you're not too sure about, just keep it simple. I had someone else tell me, you know, never take live TV for granted. And that's something I realized, you know, as soon as you're live, every single second counts. You need to be listening to what your fellow pundits are talking about. You need to be, you know, what's happening on the screen. You need to know what the producer is speaking in your ears. So that's another thing. And I definitely won't say it's easy. I thought it would be easy. It would be an easy transition. But a couple of weeks in, I think I'm getting more comfortable at it. And yeah, I don't think it's, like in the end, you've got to speak about sport, and I'm speaking about football at the end of it, something I've done all my life. So I won't say it's easy, but something I'm enjoying at the moment. Yeah.
Since you've mentioned that it was difficult, and you know, it was nothing as to what you had expected. I'm sure that, you know, there would have been moments which would have left you embarrassed, or, you know, made you feel silly at the moment, and now you can probably laugh about it because those were your initial days. So any such moment, you know, which you now think about it is something that you find incredibly silly, but at the moment when it happened, you are like, oh my god, what have I done, and this is probably my last show as a broadcaster? Any such moment?
Yeah, I don't think I had any moment where probably this will be my last time as a broadcaster, but I had a lot of moments where I would say something and in my head I would be like, what am I saying? Like, you know, this is not exactly what I planned to say, and I've just said it. But yeah, it's never sounded silly, because as soon as you say something silly or something that's not making sense, you'll obviously get feedback from the producer right away. Like, you know, it's not like you'll get feedback the next day or something like that. Straight away in your ear, you'll get something like, listen, you cannot be saying this, or what are you saying? But I don't think I've said anything silly for that matter. But I've done a bit of commentary recently, so I'm very new to commentary, and that's something I've done recently. So a few times I've said things where I don't have an example off the top of my head, but I've said it, and as soon as I've said it, I've just been like, what am I saying in my head? I've just gone like, what am I saying? This is not exactly what I want to say, like similar. But yeah, these things happen with everybody. I've seen it with a lot of the pros as well. When you say something, you don't intend saying it that way, but you just, you know, in the spur of the moment, you just say it. But yeah, there are a lot of things. You just got to make sure, you know, you're ready to speak about something else right away, or just correct that and, you know, speak sense. That's all.
Is there any practice also, or is there any preparation apart from, you know, I'm not talking of, you know, doing the research or preparing numbers or, you know, being thorough with it. But apart from that, do you, now that you've taken up commentary, do you also practice, you know, coming up with a few special phrases? Because where I'm coming from, so I'll be very honest, I haven't watched a lot of football. I watch a lot of cricket, and a lot of cricket commentators have said that they do tend to work on a few lines, a few catchphrases that, you know, they imagine, okay, that if this happens, then I'd want to use that. So is it a practice that you also indulge yourself in, or you just like to take it, you know, you just want to be thorough with your numbers, and you're like, if I'm able to do this, then I can leave the task of maybe, you know, covering a hype moment, or, you know, get saying the right words for that moment to your fellow commentator?
No, definitely. Like you mentioned, there's a lot of prep that goes in, not just with your stats and numbers, because, you know, sometimes you'll be commentating, or you'll be doing a punditry with a fellow commentator or someone. So, you know, you've got to be able to take over if it's a situation where, you know, you suddenly need to add to the moment, right? And I've been actually doing speech and vocab classes, learning a lot of new phrases that I can add, a lot of new words that you can add to, you know, the punditry or the commentary. I think it's really important. It's just like any other thing, you know, it's not a profession where you can just sit around and take it easy, and then the day you're going live is when you just go live and speak about things. You have to prep just like any other profession. And I think as well with broadcast as well, with commentary as well, it's live in the moment, right? So you need to know what to say, how to say it, and things like that. So I have been doing classes, and you know, I've been working on myself, and I just hope to get only better. I've also taken a little bit of inspiration from Dinesh Karthik, because I read a few articles about him, and everyone's going gaga over him and his punditry and things like that. So I did read up about him, and he's also someone who mentioned that it's not, you know, he is playing the sport, right? You can't just make that transition into broadcast and it'll just be seamless. You have to do your research, and you have to get better at speaking as well. And that's something I'm doing too.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of people because I was hearing him for the first time during the World Test Championship, I was very, very impressed with him. In fact, I'd even tweeted that I had only heard him for the first half hour of the game, and he had already become my favorite Indian commentator. So definitely he would have put in a lot of hours and work, you know, into it, which we are not aware of. And, you know, like you said, it's like any other profession, that once you reach the top, talent can only take you that much. After that, you also have to put in the hard work like you do, whether it be, you know, playing cricket or playing football or any other profession, whether you are an artist. So you very rightly put it there. Now, you know, just one last question before, you know, I let you go and not bore you anymore. Now, this is something that, you know, I tend to ask a lot of my guests as well. How much do you think can sportspersons impact a society in a way? And I'm not just talking in terms of, you know, impacting the society in a way that it impacts the sport in the society, but other million ways as well. You know, like how you were helping people during the second wave. I don't want to go into it because you're not comfortable about it. But, you know, just on the whole, what is your idea of a sports person helping the society after he's done playing, or even when he's playing, or she for that matter?
I think it's massive, you know, like for the kind of platform you know, sports people have these days. You know, they've got thousands and millions of followers. So, you know, tomorrow, just a simple gesture from any sportsman saying that, you know, just be kind or just donate to a certain cause. And I'm not saying the thousands and millions will go ahead and do that, but even out of that, if you get a couple of hundred who do that, that's massive for you. I'm just giving a small example of an incident that happened with me as well when I was helping out with a couple of people. And they got to know that I was doing that. I got a few text messages in saying, you know, we got to know you're doing this and it's so nice of you that you're doing that. And they said they feel like doing it themselves when they went back home and they started doing the same thing, helping out with neighbors or whoever's in need, you know. So I feel like, you know, kindness and this sort of, you know, just helping out has a domino effect, right? And I feel like if you have a platform, whether it could be even a couple of hundred people following you. It doesn't have to be millions of people following you. Just a couple of hundred people following you. And if you can make a change in their lives, whatever it is in whatever aspect, and if you have that platform, then why not? If you can make a change for the good, I think you should do that. And sportsmen definitely have it. I'm thinking of when I was growing up and I saw a couple of footballers in my team. There were a couple of them who were so kind to just people around and were helping, you know. Could be a person on the road would help them out with a meal or something like that. And I would see that and that's something I learned from them, right? So, and if you have that platform and is a sportsman you look up to, and I feel there is also a moral obligation when you have such a big fan following and things like that. I feel it's important that you, you know, because you're a role model to so many of them. I think it's, you have that platform, so you should make use of it. So I think, every sportsman or everybody for that matter who can just make a change, a good difference in society should go ahead and do it.
Well, it was definitely, you know, very great to know about it and the inspiration behind what you did, you know, why you did it and what were the things which led to it. I, you know, really want to say that I was in huge admiration of what you were doing during a very tough time period for a lot of us. And I'd like to actually thank you on the behalf of all those people who appreciated that work and wouldn't be able to reach out to you. So I think that is something, you know, a lot of people who follow you and who follow Indian football would be extremely proud of, that, you know, someone who from their very own fraternity did it. And, you know, I hope that, you know, this motivates you to do a lot of other good things and other good stuff for the society that keeps us, all of us, and makes the country a better place. You know, on this note, I'd just like to thank you for taking out the time for coming on the show and speaking to us about your journey, about the challenges you faced, and, you know, now your commentary. I hope, you know, you enjoyed it and, you know, you feel that this would reach a few people and might create a positive impact.
No, definitely. Thank you so much for having me. You know, I really had a good time. It's important we speak about these few things. Because I feel like people also need to know about, you know, the struggles that are required about, you know, trying to make it professionally in football, in the country especially. You know, people are so used to watching videos of footballers with fancy cars and fancy houses and things like that. And it's not always all rosy. You know, there's a lot of work that goes behind the scenes. So I hope it's a bit of an eye-opener for everyone. And yeah, I just hope this reaches a lot of people and educates a lot of people on issues like these.
Well, thank you so much. So this was it from this episode of Gupshup with Gil. If you liked it, please do share it with your friends and family and whosoever you think, you know, is a sports fan, not particularly a football fan. And if you've liked our other previous work and, you know, want to look for more such content on sports related interviews, please do follow, please do subscribe to the channel and, you know, keep looking out for more content on Gupshup with Gil. We'll try our best to bring you whatever best that we can. And hopefully it's good enough that you know share it with others as well. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, Darren, once again. We hope you enjoyed it.